Thank you, everybody, for coming. My golden jubilee. Ago, I sat down at the piano, scribbled out some musical notes. They weren't much, but they were mine. Took a little bit of time. That was 50 years ago. Day I came to life, my golden jubilee. So many empty rooms, me and my piano, jamming on some tune I just wrote. The first dance for a song. Feel it, it's exactly what I want. After 50 years of this, I feel it just as strong. From a coffee shop in Washington to a roadhouse by the highway in Redondo Beach, I write them and I play them. It's all that I can do. I can play the fool and I can preach. So, one afternoon in September of 1972, 50 years ago this month, I came home from school to my mother and father's house, went down to the basement to my mother's Cable Nelson piano, and did something I had no idea I could do. I wrote a song. This song. All alone in an airport, by another magazine, moving through a crowded lobby, fighting people feeling mean. Don't know why I came here, liked it better where I was. Mister, get me out of this airport, get me back to my love. Up until then, I just figured that songwriting was some kind of alchemy that I couldn't do, you know, coming up with an original melody and lyrics and everything. And then all of a sudden, one day I sat down, I wrote that song. A few days later, I wrote another song, and then I wrote another song and another song. Pretty soon, I was writing a song every day. I had the good sense, actually, not to really show them to anybody. And actually, that sounds a lot better now than it did back in 1972, but that was like the best of the bunch for quite a while. But it was about a year and a half later, over a year and a half later, actually, I saw a notice in the Dowling Aqua in the school newspaper that there was going to be a senior talent show. It's my senior year, and I thought, what the hell, you know? So I'll write a song, and February 11th, 1974, there's a poster hanging in my music room of the Beatles' performance at the Washington Coliseum on February 11th, 1964, 10 years to the day earlier, their first performance in the United States of America. 10 years later, I was going to do my first performance of one of my original songs at the Dowling talent show. So I got myself a spot, and I want to give you guys a taste of what this all looked like, give you a feel for what these people saw on February 11th, 1974. Don't worry, it's just me. Most of you are old enough to get that. Anyway, so then I launched into the first original song I ever played in front of anybody except maybe my friend Dennis and a few other people. This is it. Raw spaghetti doesn't bother me. Life is different since you found my tree. You got your arms around me and I can hardly breathe. All I need is you to make me heave. Don't forget that you are my onion. Forget that you are my prune. If you ask me, you should have been a nun then. You melt my stomach like a big balloon. And that one goes on for a while. And that was it. That was the first. And it's true. You were there. You heard it. That's the song that I played. You know, that was 1974, February 11th, 10 years after the Beatles' first appearance in the United States was mine. So anyway, I got done playing that, and I heard something I'd never heard before, and something I didn't expect, and it just threw me for a loop. Applause. People were clapping for me. They were, and it wasn't just, you know, clapping. They were enthusiastic. They were going. The crowd was going wild, as they say. I'd never heard that before, and I'd never had that feeling before. And I decided right there and then, well, this is what I'm going to do with the rest of my life. Forget everything else, you know. This is what I'm going to do. You know, actually, Sully, you played that day too, and with Pat Bump. They're still playing together. You know, 50 years. This is their 50th year too, but. You know, I decided that's what I was going to do. And so I did do a year of college because I didn't have the, I guess I could say this in a bar, didn't have the balls to drop out of school right then and there. I did a year of college, managed to drop out of school. And the next song is the first song I ever wrote. And then I had my freshman year in college where I actually took all the money I made the summer before and bought an organ and put it in my room, a Baldwin organ, so I could have something to practice and write songs on. And people still remember that. You know, 50 years later, they still remember the guy. By the book, it's in the book, the guy in the room on the 1,200 floor at Bird's that had the organ, you know. And my roommates, it made their year miserable, too, because they bore the brunt of that as well. But it was after I dropped out of school in June of 1975 that I wrote this next song. Which actually goes to prove, if anybody thinks that I'm sitting here telling you that I have any natural talent, you know, or if you think that this guy's got natural talent, keep in mind, this next song is the oldest song I ever wrote that I still play. I wrote it in June of 1975, 2.5 years after I wrote my first song. I'd been writing songs every day. I had written some about 400 to 450 songs by the time I finally came up with this one. And so it isn't natural talent. It goes back to that. If you put an infinite number of monkeys in a room with an infinite number of typewriters, you know, sooner or later, one of them is going to type out Hamlet. And that's basically it. So I finally came up with this song. Now, I could write a book about this song, basically. But, you know, that'd be my next book probably. But there's so many stories. The story I'm going to tell is this one. And I don't know if there's anybody here who hasn't heard this story before, but you're going to hear it. You're going to hear it again now. So I dropped out of college, got my job back as a Pinkerton guard, which is about the most miserable job that you can have in the world, you know, thinking that this is, unless something happens, this is, I thought I was going to be picked up. I thought Sony Records was going to be waiting at the house with a contract just because I wrote that song. You know, the Ross Spaghetti song, but they weren't. So I'm working as a security guard all summer long, 1975. I take some of the money that I made. I go into Larium Studios on 28th Street, just between Ingersoll and Grand, and I record a demo of five songs. End of September, I buy one of those one-month Greyhound bus passes that you can go anywhere in the country for a month on the Greyhound buses. First week, I go down to Nashville. I've got kin down in Nashville, and you know, cousins and uncles and stuff, and an aunt, and I go back in those days. You could actually go to Music Row, and you could go door to door, and the producers and the record people would actually talk to you and listen to your demos. And I went for a couple days, and I realized I had nothing to sell. That it wasn't going to happen for me down then. So I still had 3 weeks left to go on the bus pass. I decided that before I quit, before I gave up, I was going to play my songs for John Lennon, the Beatle. So I did a week in Nashville, went up, spent a night in Washington, where I was born, and then went to New York City. I got a room at the YMCA at Central Park, and first morning, Monday morning, I went to the Avenue of Americas to the building where John Lennon's office was. I went up to his office, and his secretary was up there, and I said, "Well, I'd like to meet John Lennon." She says, "Well, you can't." And I said, "Well, you know, I came all the way from Iowa." And he said, "Well, you can't." And I said, "You know, I haven't had a bath for you. I can tell that." You know, I go on and on. And I go, finally, she pulls out the appointment book, gets out her pencil, and she calls upstairs, and she says, "Okay, Thursday at 1 o'clock," and writes me in to see John Lennon on Thursday at 1 o'clock, takes my cassette. You know, I'm in. And I've got 4 days to kill now. So, you know, I'm calling everybody I know who would care, which is basically my friend Dennis, you know. He cared because he and I used to listen to Beatles albums together, you know, I do the New York stuff. You know, I go to the top of the Empire State Building. You know, I look across at the the Statue of Liberty. I buy pizzas that's as big as a table and all that stuff. All the New York City stuff, I do that. And I'm just waiting for Thursday to come. Thursday comes. First thing in the morning, 5 o'clock in the morning, I'm up. I go down to the basement of the YMCA, and I take a shower. Now, I've taken my life in my hands. I'm taking a shower in the basement of the YMCA. You don't do that unless you've got some very important business. And I had important business. So I was at 5 o'clock in the morning. So then at 10 o'clock, I go up to the front of the office building. I got a 1 o'clock appointment. I'm up in front of the office building at 10 o'clock. Oh, look, Bob Dylan just walked in. No, that's not Bob Dylan. Oh, but that's like Des Moines' Bob Dylan who's the woman?
Joan Baez.
Joan Baez. I'm standing outside the building at 10 o'clock in the morning, and then at noon I decide I'm taking the elevator up. I'm not going to be 1 minute late. It's a 1 o'clock appointment. Took the elevator up, went to John Lennon's office. John wasn't there. I got stood up. Now instead of John Lennon, they had me talk to on a good day I can remember the guy's name. His last name was Simon, but he was the A&R guy at John Lennon's record company. And if you've got something to sell, the A&R guy is the guy you want to see anyway. And he was very nice. He spent the whole afternoon with me. And unlike the producers and record people in Nashville who did what they always do, which is listen to a few seconds of your song, then fast forward to the next song, this guy listened to the entire tape from beginning to end and gave me a good hour's worth of constructive criticism. Now, when you're 19 years old, you don't want constructive criticism. You want a record contract, you know. So at the time, but as time went on, as my life went on, I actually thought back on some of that and I actually heeded it. And it actually helped me to some degree. But anyway, I guess stood up by John Lennon. So I was watching this film about 10 years ago called United States of America versus John Lennon. And his lawyer gets on, and his lawyer is saying, you know, there was one day in John Lennon's life that was the very best day of his life, one Thursday in October. He goes, number one, it was his 35th birthday. When the secretary made the appointment for me on Monday, she had to know that it was going to be his 35th birthday. What she didn't know was that that's the day that his son Sean was going to be born. So instead of meeting with me in his office, he's up there, you know, seeing his son being born at the apartments where they live, department complex. And to top it all off, that's the day that he finds out that 2 days earlier, the Supreme Court had ruled that he could stay in the country. So, long story short, if I can even say that now, you know, this next song is a song that John Lennon would have heard if he wouldn't have stood me up on October 6, 1975. Lord, ain't there no way I could get on a bus and take these blues to someplace I can do something for them back where I was given them. Mother Blues, don't you love your son? Mother Blues, don't you love your son? You gotta help me run. Don't you love your son? It had to come. Mother Blues, I'm your only son. I've been a very patient son. Help me run. All that I needed was a ticket for home to find out all the pleasures I missed in this unfriendly city. Now I'll take one anywhere. Son, help me run. I used to play this song in East Village at the Village Bean. I miss the Village Bean, especially during the caucus season. That was an exciting time to be in Des Moines. It had to come. Mother Blues, I'm your only son. I've been a very patient son. Help me run. Well, it had to come. Mother Blues, I'm your only son. I've been a very patient son. Mother Blues, don't you love your son? Of all the 5,000 songs I've written, that's the oldest one that I still play. Thank you very much. And I had to write 450 songs before I wrote a good one. And by the way, Randy Kong did an excellent graphic of me on the John Lennon birthday about 3 or 4 years ago. Randy Kong, the subject of the award-winning documentary, his name is Randy. That's Randy Kong right there. Anyway. By the way, my wife is sitting down here. You had something you wanted to tell the mayor about the lights on 54th Street? I want to talk about those rotaries. You know, what do they call them? They call them roundabouts. We call them rotaries in Massachusetts, where I used to go miles and miles out of my way to avoid the big one on Grafton Street in Worcester. But anyway, maybe, you know, well, when I'm mayor, I'll go down in history for tearing them all out. But that'll never happen. I can't get elected dog catcher. Do we even have a dog catcher? I hope not. But a reading from the good book. Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart lived from 1756 to 1791. Ludwig von Beethoven lived from 1770 to 1827. John Ronald Lennon lived from 1940 to 1980. If, for whatever reason, anyone ever asked you, when did B. John Burns live? There is a definite, unequivocal answer. B. John Burns lived from Halloween Eve, 1976, to August 19th, 1977, 3 days after Elvis died. A reading from the Gospel, according to B. John. Ron, are you here?
No.
No. You know, it's somebody in Marion bought my book.
Yeah, and you said if I ordered it on that day, it would get here, you could sign it, and it didn't, so now you have to sign this chest.
I'll give you the $39.75, actually. You didn't get it yet? Did you order it from Book Baby?
I did.
Okay, well, anyway. Somebody in Des Moines, right? Did you order it from Book Baby? Okay. Well, I can tell where the orders are coming from. I don't know who's doing the orders. Anyway, I had this very dramatic thing I was going to do after I read that book, and then my train of thought gets broken. I don't know if that happens to everybody, but it happens to me. Anyway, anybody who knows me or seen one of my shows and has been to this part of my show knows that the one significant thing that I did in my life was the period that I was on the road with a band called Baby Lester and the Buggy Bumpers. Looking back on it now, I realize that the whole experience only lasted for 293 days, but I had so many adventures during that time, I resolved that someday I was going to sit down and I was going to commit it all to paper. You know, I wrote the first draft of this in 1996. You know, and I did draft after draft after draft, and then, the band only lasted 293 days, and it basically ended 3 days after Elvis died, and that was the end of the greatest experience of my life, basically. But Lester and I stayed friends after that. We stayed good friends, and he was my best man at my wedding in 1990. And a few weeks later, Donna, his wife, who was going to be here, but she couldn't make it, called me up and said, we're having a 40th birthday party for baby Lester. Can you come? Of course I could come. So I came. I wrote a song for it. And then in 1996, I wrote the first draft of this book, and I've written other drafts since then. I woke up one day earlier this year, part of my Golden Jubilee celebration, and decided I've got to finish this book. I've got to get it out there. We lost both of our drummers in the last couple of years, so there were three of us left, and Lester hadn't been doing too good. So I decided I wanted to get the book done while Lester was still with us, you know, and while I was still with us, and Donna too. And so, you know, this year basically I focused on finishing the book. And getting it published, and I went to Book Baby, self-publishing it, got it done. Went out on ebook on Kindle on the 17th of June. On the 16th of June, I drove to Omaha, gave Baby Lester his copy of the book, gave Donna her copy of the book, and then 3 weeks later, I was on tour. You know, I was playing in Mesa, Arizona, and Redlands, California, when I was in Mesa, I accidentally butt dialed Lester's daughter. And Lester was there, so I had a nice conversation with baby Lester then. 3 days later, I woke up in San Clemente, and there was a message from baby Lester's daughter saying, call me back, there's something I need to tell you. And I knew what that was going to be. But before he went, baby Lester took what was left of his inheritance money and bought copies of this book for each one of his grandchildren. That's a true story, actually. Anyway, this is a song I wrote for his 40th birthday party. It's up all the way? I think we have the same issue. Well, I've got an easy answer for that one. I probably stepped on it. I told you I'd be tripping over chords all night tonight. You getting it now? There we go. I got a call on a hot August day. This must be my orders to ride. There was silence, and I heard a sigh. And a voice so uncharacteristically sad. You said our luck was always so bad. After we said our goodbyes, we swore out a pact. Baby Lester turns 40. There'll be a hell of a party. We'll both be losing our hair. We'll have money to spare. We'll be all settled down. When baby Lester turns 40, we'll tell some hellacious stories about our life on the road all the long years ago before I rode out of town. In the 10 years that followed, we both finished school. Both started families and jobs. In the glorious stories I told, baby Lester was gone. If I'd call you and ask why it ended so fast, you'd say, don't try to relive the past. But as long as these fingers can play, that memory will last. Baby Lester turns 40, there'll be a hell of a party. We'll both be losing our hair, we'll have money to spare, we'll be all settled down. But baby Lester turns 40, we'll tell some hellacious stories about our life on the road all the long years ago before I rode out of town. Now we all drink a beer on a hot August day. Then we break out the guitars. That's how we remember just who we are. I smile and imagine we're up on a stage in Texas, Ohio, or here. We built us a bridge back over the hose here. Baby Lester turns 40, there'll be a hell of a party. We'll both be losing our hair, we'll have money to spare, we'll be all settled down. Baby Lester turns 40, we'll tell some hellacious stories about our life on the road all the long years ago before I rode out of town. I already did the third verse tonight. Lester turns 40. We'll tell some hellacious stories. Too much of a good thing. We'll both be losing our hair. We'll have money to spare. We'll be all settled down. When baby Lester turns 40, we'll tell some hellacious stories about our life on the road all the long years ago before I rode out of town. Thank you very much. Thank you. My tribute to a guy that took a young boy out of the suburbs and showed him the world. This one. I wrote this song, I think, in 2003. And I wrote it, I recorded it. I didn't memorize it. I never played it except last Thursday out in the front yard when I realized I had it memorized. I didn't really want to memorize it because of all the songs that I've written, this is the one that, as many times as I've listened to it, it's the one that could still bring tears to my eyes when I hear it. I didn't want to ruin that. But last Thursday, I decided that I had it memorized and I got to start playing it. And anyway, I'll see if I can do it now. Queen Elizabeth, they say you're slowing down. Once I watched you strike a regal pose, I still see it now. I would rather meet a tragic fate than live to see you abdicate another in your throne, Queen Elizabeth. I am loyal to the throne. And another in your throne, Queen Elizabeth. I am loyal to the throne. Thank you, thank you. And you know, that song's not what you think it's about, actually. When I wrote that song in 2003, I had a 14-year-old Jack Russell Terrier named Lizzie, and you know, was 14 years old, so you kind of figured, you know, she's pretty much at the end of her run and everything. And so we got another 2 years out of her, but I wrote that song at that time. The lovely Elizabeth is what they called her when we got her. And she wasn't named after Queen Elizabeth. She was named after the lovely Elizabeth, who was Hulk Hogan's manager, you know, ended up marrying Randall Macho Man Savage. And the night we got Lizzie, we went to the drive-in theater and watched the Hulk Hogan movie and everything. But anyway, you know, the song always brought tears to my eyes, but then last Thursday, and I heard the news, and I realized I had it memorized. So, what the heck? So here it is today. Well, so much for the history stuff. It's time to introduce the band. Background singers, JB and BJ. You know, I first used them for my birthday, my 60th birthday show at the Des Moines Playhouse 7 years ago. And after that, basically, I've kept them locked in my basement. You know, and the only time I brought them out really was last New Year's Eve and the New Year's Eve before when I did my live stream, my New Year's Eve live stream. Well, two years ago, I went for 12 and a half hours straight without a break. And with my background singers behind me. Then last year, I went for 9.5 hours last year. I didn't have the stamina. But at any rate, so I actually wrote this song last New Year's Eve day, you know, but, you know, as I was bringing them out to use them at my show, you know, I couldn't memorize it in that short a time. So you're hearing, this is the first time anybody's, except my dog, Gucci, Bella, has ever heard this. We're gonna pay for this. It's just downright wrong. What you can't know can't hurt us, with the theory all along. Tonight I'm needing my backup singers. Can't just bring in a pair of ringers. Tonight I'm letting them out and putting them on. Let's let the twins out of the basement, cause there's gonna be a show. Let the twins run free on New Year's Eve, mingle with the family, just don't let them go. Let the twins out of the basement for a show. They wouldn't survive for long in the big outside world. Their hearts are better broken, frozen, broken by the girls. Who are we really kidding? We'll be looking at years in prison if we mess up now and our ugly secret unfurls. Let's let the twins out of the basement, cause there's gonna be a show. Let the twins run free on New Year's Eve, mingle with the family, just don't let them go. Let the twins out of the basement for a show. And when you hear their shrieks of gratitude, you may ease up on the platitudes, try to understand. Let's let the twins out of the basement, cause there's gonna be a show. Let the twins run free on New Year's Eve, mingle with the family, just don't let them go. Let the twins out of the basement, let the twins out of the basement, cause there's gonna be a show. Let the twins run free on New Year's Eve, mingle with the family, just don't let them go. Let the twins out of the basement, whoa, just don't let them go. Over here, Andy, out of the basement, that way, Randy. Get it warm, warm, twins out of the warm for a show. Warm, 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 keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going, thank you. Okay, thank you, thank you. Let the twins out of the basement. I owe Randy more than just showing where the bathroom is. Actually, I've got my nucleus of supporters here. I've got Nancy and Randy and the people that religiously listen to my live stream every Tuesday. And then, of course, there's the number one music fans in Des Moines, actually, Rick and Linda, Yeah, and they come to all my shows. I don't know how they do it because they come to everybody else's shows, which is almost impossible to do right now because that Porch Fest is going on and everybody is playing today. Everybody's playing today. So I think Linda was the first one to actually buy the book, actually. And then we got the Haggertys. I don't have time to play the song about the windows today, but there's a song about the Haggertys. And then there's this song, which is a new one. It's a message song. I think you'll like it. Brand new message song. Let's get started. Okay. Don't say I never gave you nothing. You know your COVID came from me. Don't say I never gave you nothing. You know your COVID came from me. If you would not have my loving, I wore a little gift, you're wearing it right now, I see. Not even I could be so vile to bring it on intentionally. You detect a little smile, I don't deny a sense of glee. That's neither wrong nor right, I guess I finally had an impact on your life. Don't say I never gave you nothing, you know your COVID came from me. Don't say I never gave you nothing. You know your COVID came from me. When you would not accept my loving, I brought a little gift. You're wearing it right now, I see. All this rhetoric from you about the weakness that you see in me. Sometimes it rang a little true. I didn't always disagree. Who's the weak one now? I'm not disinclined to kick you when you're down. Don't say I never gave you nothing. You know your COVID came from me. Don't say I never gave you nothing. You know your COVID came from me. When you would not accept my loving, I brought a little gift. You're wearing it right now, I see. don't say I never gave you nothing. You know your COVID came from me. Don't say I never gave you nothing. You know your COVID came from me. When you would not accept my loving, I brought a little gift. You're wearing it right now, I see. Oh, when you would not accept my loving, I brought a little gift. You're wearing it right now, I see. Don't say I never gave you nothing. You know your COVID came for me. Thank you. Everybody loves a message song, right? Is that Don back there? Is that Don?
Yeah.
Okay. Don and I are standing on the opposite sides of the political fence, but
who doesn't?
In this day and age. Don's a veteran, actually. So I'm gonna play this song right now. It's different era though. This is a song I wanted to write. I wanted to write this song for 20 years. And I finally got it out 2 years ago, and it just happened to come out on Veterans Day. And the story behind this was that back in June 6th of 2000, I was down at a seminar with my wife, actually, in New Orleans. And one afternoon on June 6th, my boss and I and my wife skipped out and went down to the French Quarter to watch a parade. It was a D-Day parade. And it happened to be the 54th anniversary of D-Day, and 2000 was the 55th anniversary of the end of the war, basically. I guess it was the 56th anniversary of D-Day, whatever, however the math comes out. And what the parade consisted of was all the way through the quarter was a long procession of Higgins boats, those amphibious landing craft that the military, the United States military, used to land on Omaha Beach in Normandy back on June 6, 1944. And they were these, and all as far as you could see, this went on for at least an hour, maybe more than an hour, and they were all packed to the gills with World War II veterans, and a lot of them were Medal of Honor winners. And I have to say that in my entire life, before then or after then, I don't think I've ever met or seen in person a Medal of Honor winner. And there was a bunch of them that day, and that was a big day. That was exciting to watch those guys, you know, And now you think it's 20 years later and you look at the statistics. You know, I think there was like 18 million Americans that went overseas or as part of that war effort. Back when the parade happened 22 years ago, half of them were still alive. You know, like 8 million, 9 million. Now there's like 300,000. And in 2 years, there's going to be like 50,000. And by the end of the decade, you know, they're going to be gone. They're going to all be gone. I think that's a tragedy. These are the guys that we grew up with. You know, they were our priests and our bankers and our lawyers and our uncles and everything else. And these guys went off and literally saved the world when they were 22 years old. Then somehow they came home. They came back and they got jobs and they bought houses and mortgages and they raised families and kids and everything else and just had normal lives, happy lives. You know, they went through hell. They went through hell over there. And how do you do that? How do you do that? And anyway, you know, I felt like I always wanted to write this song, and all of a sudden, like I say, on Veterans Day, it came out. My favorite high school teacher, I was baptized by that preacher, who always held a sadness in his eye. My cranky Uncle Harold and his fishing buddy Clyde, they were heroes living ordinary lives. Heroes living ordinary lives. Growing up in Springfield, they were everywhere you went. I know that there's a story, but I haven't heard it yet. Something about D-Day and the Battle of the Bulge. There are tales you don't care to divulge. With a 35-year mortgage, it was all about the kids. Like the horrors of the past, we'll never find out where you live. You went off to save the world. You weren't even 22. You say it's just what any decent man would do. My favorite high school teacher, I was baptized by that preacher who always held a sadness in his eye. Cranky Uncle Harold and his fishing buddy Clyde, they were heroes living ordinary lives. Heroes living ordinary lives. I tried to ask my dad what he was up to in the war.
He said, there's a lot I don't remember anymore. In the middle of the ocean where so many brothers fell, I don't want to go back to that hell. My mother's Uncle Michael, he was in the OSS. What he walked into at Dachau, tried for decades to suppress. He came back and got through college in the struggle to forget. In 59, he drank himself to death. My favorite high school teacher, I was baptized by that preacher who always held a sadness in his eye. My cranky Uncle Harold and his fishing buddy Clyde, they were heroes living ordinary lives. Heroes living ordinary lives. Whoa, I hate to see them go, but I reckon there's a handful still alive. Good sir, didn't realize who you were until after you had died. My favorite high school teacher, I was baptized by that preacher who always held a sadness in his eye. My cranky Uncle Harold and his fishing buddy Clyde, they were heroes living ordinary lives. Heroes living ordinary lives. My favorite high school teacher, I was baptized by that preacher who always held a sadness in his eye. My cranky Uncle Harold and his fishing buddy Clyde, they were heroes living ordinary lives. Heroes living ordinary lives. Heroes living ordinary lives. Heroes living ordinary lives.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. So Don's a veteran, you're a veteran, right? We got two, anybody else? Yeah, thank you. Thank you to all the veterans actually here. Yeah. When I was born, there was one Civil War veteran left. I might have been a Confederate actually. And died in 1957, a year after I was born. There's still quite a few World War I veterans left, and wasn't a pretty sight actually what they went through and everything. But we were surrounded by World War II veterans, and you know, a lot of the politicians, you know, all of our presidents right up until probably Nixon, maybe beyond, were World War II veterans, and then Carter was a submarine commander and everything. I think we lose something. We lose something when we don't have people that have that experience really, and you know, as our leaders and everything else. So hopefully we don't ever go through anything like that again. But whatever. So much for preaching about that. But that's my story about the war veterans. This one actually, see what I'm doing in fire time. Oh, look, and I've made all my rings, my exercise rings. I didn't even know I had exercise goals, you know, but I've met my goals. Somebody's taking all this down too. I guess Siri's jumping in probably, it sounds like. But at any rate, I wish they'd invented a watch that could just tell time, you know. Hey, Siri, what time is it? What time is it? Come on, I know you're out there. She won't. Oh, there we go. Okay, so I've still got plenty of time left. So, but the reason I'm asking is this is a song I usually would start with. This is my opening song, and that's the first few bars right there. This is the title song from A Mile from Shore. You've seen. There we go. Title song from Mile from Shore, this year's CD, and I wrote this last year. I released A Mile from Shore last year, and I like this as my opening song. And until I come up with something better, this is going to be my opening song. But today is different. Today I had different songs to open with, so you get to hear it about an hour into my, about 50 minutes into my show, about halfway through. So keep it tab. Mile offshore, I can see the lamp in your hand beckoning me. I said I need a safe place to land. Mile offshore, guess I'm home, my friend. Catch a full night of sleep again. I'm not going back out again, my friend. I'm a mile offshore, it looks like 73. So little has changed, this one-pub village I see. The windows glisten, the hills are green. I hear your voice calling out to me. From here we both could be 17 again. I
I hear your mother and father are gone. They say I'm not the type you can depend upon. Looking in from this line of sight, I can only say your mother and father were right. While offshore, the dolphins dance by my hull, circling me to the lilting song of the gulls. I know that's what I've been sailing toward. When I tie down, you can climb aboard for a little dance. It's a sweet reward to ourselves. From my long, clear history of selfish deeds, I come home with only apologies. There's no blame if you turn your back. To hell with that, you're out there waiting for me. While offshore, I can see the lamp in your hand. Oh, 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 oh. While offshore, I guess I found a soft place to land. Whoa, oh, 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 oh. While offshore, oh, oh, oh. While offshore, oh, oh, oh. While offshore, oh, oh, oh.
Thank you. A Mile Offshore. And by the way, that's the first of my albums that I put out on the streaming services. Now I've got like 13, I think. And this year, one of the things I've been doing as part of my Golden Jubilee is putting all my old albums out on the streaming services, Spotify and Amazon Music and Apple Music and iTunes and YouTube Music and Deezer and a bunch of ones I never even heard of before and that are in Asia and the Far East and everything else. If you're in the Far East, you can listen to my music on Anjami, I think, or one of those services like that. But that was the first one I put out. And if you're on Spotify, follow me, you know, because I guess that helps. And Spotify actually has been better to me than any of the other ones. But I'm up to like $10.44 in royalties, and that's for 6,500 plays actually. So it's truly it is. I've made more money selling 32 copies of that book. I've made like seven times as much money as I made from getting 6,500 followers on Spotify. So, okay, so Garbage Day. And I just played the title song from last year's CD, Mile from Shore. This year's CD, Garbage Day. I don't start recording my CD until October 1st. None of these songs have been recorded yet, and I've already got the album cover, you know, because, you know, I get my work done by, I don't know how many people have heard of Sean Palak, the artist from, you know Sean Palak, you know, actually, there's a song about him and your niece, actually, that I wrote, but when she was doing the mural in his house and everything, Sean Palak has been doing most of my artwork. Since 2009, I've had like 13 CDs, and he's done seven of them, and everything. He did Mile from Shore, and then he did Garbage Day. I tell him what I want to do, and then he does it. So anyway, hopefully I'll live until October, and I can get that album. Hi, Judge. And how you doing? It's good to see you. I think there might be other judges here. My eyesight's not too good in the dark light. Well, it's dark for me. I don't know if it's dark for you, but what? Well, you know, I'm lucky actually. You know, I made a vow never to walk into another courthouse or jail again as a lawyer. You know, I go in as a prisoner or something, but you know. I've kept that for 3 years, you know. Anyway, title song from Garbage Day. I wrote this song about a couple months ago, and as Renee knows, every Thursday, if the weather's good and I don't have something else, I just set up on the front lawn and play some songs, you know, for 2 hours. Just gives me a chance to practice with my equipment and try some stuff out, and people come out. people come out and listen, and people drive by and they stop, and sometimes it's just me. But the guy Bob across the street, you know, he's doing yard work, and I wrote this song, and I played it a couple days later out in my front yard, and Bob came by afterwards. He goes, you know that one song, Garbage Day? He goes, I really like that. So I thought, well, somebody likes it. That's always a good first step. I could get some streams on Spotify. I could get another 0.8 cents or something, you know, if I get 30 streams. Anyway, this is the title song from an album I haven't started recording yet. It doesn't seem like I'm letting go. It's like taking a cruise and I just got home. Door is unlocked, but I'm all alone, and it's garbage day. I'll say that I miss the activity, poor souls who attempted to live with me. Forget about all the insanity on garbage day. Don't look at me, I've got nothing to send, and I'm not playing that game again. Excuse me, I just lost a friend on garbage day. Played all the cards very close to my chest, always believed it was for the best. No one will care when they lay me to rest on garbage day. No one is taking a surgical knife to the fractured remains of my life. Out of mind, out of sight on garbage day. Don't look at me, I've got nothing to send. I'm not playing that game again. Excuse me, I just lost a friend on garbage day. On garbage day. On garbage day. Thank you. Garbage Day. So that one will be finished. Usually I start them on October 1st and finish them at the end of the month. That one will be finished and out there and probably the 1st of November, and it should be the 1st of December. It should be out in the streaming services. So like I say, if you're on Spotify, follow me on Spotify. You can go to YouTube Music and listen to my stuff and not be a member, and you have to look at ads, but you know, you might like something in the ads. You know, maybe there'll be an ad for my book. You never know. You never know. Here's another message song. This is my theme song when I'm on the road, actually. And you know, since I started doing this, I've played my music in 26 states, and a lot of them with Baby Lester and the Buggy Bumpers, but quite of them have been as a solo person. And since I started doing the solo thing, I played my songs in Washington, D.C., and Washington State, California, and Ohio and Indiana, and you know, I just did Arizona and Mississippi and a couple times in New Orleans and Georgia and everything. Every place I go, people will say to me, well, John, you know, you're a writer from Iowa. Tell us something about Iowa. And so this song is kind of an educational song about Iowa. If you need credit for something, you know, as we lawyers say, CLE credit. You know, you've got the mayor of Johnston here. You got the president of the Iowa Bar Association is up there somewhere, I think. You know, we got judges, and then we got lawyers. Well, I won't point anybody out because they might not be members of the Bar Association, but I'm not. But I'm not a lawyer. I'm a full-time singer-songwriter. But anyway, what was I talking about? Oh, my theme song about Iowa. Well, I stood up on center stage to play my newest song. Everyone reacts like I was doing something wrong. Steve was on the bass. He played far more gigs than I. Softly whispered, if you gotta die, here we'll be just fine. He said, you must remember Clear Lake back in winter 59. A
man named Buddy Holly played the guitar one last time. The one enduring image of him waving from the plane. After 60 years, the legend still remains. The image doesn't change. Rocky Marciano, Grant, and Holly, that's just three. If you die in Iowa, you're in good company. If you have to die in Iowa, it ain't no tragedy. 50 wins and 50 fights as no other fighters claim. Rocky Marciano tried to fly it through the rain. Just outside of Newton in an isolated field with Willie Farrell's brother at the wheel. The record, it was sealed. This is the one most people don't know about. Oh, Judy, Judy, Judy was his most familiar line. At the Adler down in Davenport, they had him on at nine. Back in the hotel room, he sat coloring his hair. Cary Grant, completely unaware that fate would catch him there. Rocky Marciano, Grant, and Holly, that's just three. If you die in Iowa, you're in good company. If you have to die in Iowa, it ain't no tragedy. So fortified by history, I continued with my song till the whole damn room was empty. But regardless, I played on, 'cause the ghosts of Marciano, of Holly, and of Grant almost seemed to guide my picking hand. You can call it my last stand. Rocky Marciano, Grant, and Holly, that's just three. If you die in Iowa, you're in good company. If you have to die in Iowa, it ain't no tragedy.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. So you have to tell Willie I played that song, you know. This is a song, you know, I mentioned the absolute worst thing that happened in his life, actually. And he requests it. He requests it. You know, I make light of it, but he requests it. So tell him I played it. Tell him I played it. With respect. With respect. I played it with respect. I've got a lot of respect and everything. Okay, Tom just walked in. Tom gave me a lot of work, actually, for years, actually, when he was the executive director of Uptown Bill's Coffee Shop in Iowa City. And he was the... This year, well, you're going to hear this one then, because...
I have to go back to...
Okay. Oh, yeah, just Tom just had surgery a couple days ago. But anyway, Uptown Bill's, you know, which is just a magical place to be. Iowa City, you know, it's not just bad passes and bad calls by referees and stuff like that. They're tearing it down. They're tearing it down. And I'm sitting there with a pad and paper and a guitar. And every time they tear something, a piece of my past down in Iowa City, I write a song. And so I'm watching there, and there's somebody's posting video of them tearing down Uptown Bill's. And so this comes out. This comes out just as they're tearing down Uptown Bill's. They tore down Uptown Bill's today. I was expecting it anyway. It hurts to see, even for me. I'd come to visit occasionally. I guess it's just a place. What does that make me? They tore down Uptown Bill's today. I'm guessing once I saw Zolo play all the weekend tunes, Americana and blues. Sometimes I'd come in my dancing shoes. It's sad today. I just heard the news. You know, Sactor, he never set a foot in that place. You couldn't be there without seeing his face. Guess it's just a place. What does that make me? They tore down Uptown Bill's today. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. They tore down Uptown Bills, and, you know, someday they'll move somewhere else, I suppose, but good times. And Tom basically built that place. He kept Bill Sactor alive for about 10 years, really. So if you've seen the movie Bill with Mickey Rooney and Dennis Quaid, or the sequel Bill 2, there's not even a sequel to His Name is Randy. There should be. There should be, but there is one for Bill. And anyway, this Tom there, that he knew all the great touring regional musicians, the two, because they all made a stop at Uptown Bill's. So now he roams the Drake neighborhoods, and he's actually a retired reporter, and he's kind of like the voice of the Drake Neighborhood Association. So Tom Gilson, man. I played a song earlier about Queen Elizabeth, you know, and it wasn't about Queen Elizabeth. This song, it kind of is. Prince Harry in the better half went out, traded in the Cadillac, bought a condo on the cul-de-sac, had 30 years to pay it down. Disillusioned with the palace life, says, I don't like the way they treat my wife. I tried to take it, but I'm not the type. So, Dad, I'm handing in the crown. The Queen is telling me, think to sell. The Queen should know what this is all about. I watched the way she pushed my mama out. That will not fly this time around. The Queen should know that I am not my dad. I'm just like mama. I guess that's bad. And if she don't like it, she can just stay mad. Because I'm not backing down. Queen is telling me you gotta learn. If you're a comedy, you gotta earn. That is your majesty a true concern, but it's not your business now. The Queen is telling me, think this out. The Queen she's telling me to think. Get it right, John. The Queen is telling me, watch your mouth. It's my decision what I care about. You're my subject and you won't act out in the presence of the crown. Prince just snorted and he flew the nest. Now Vancouver is the new address. The Queen of England is a real hot mess. Diana wins another round. Diana wins another round. Thank you. Diana wins another round. You know, maybe I should show more respect and everything, but I did play that nice song earlier, but of course that one was about a dog, you know. We saw the Queen in person. We saw Prince Philip, Prince Charles, Margaret Thatcher. I want to say Prince Charles. I said Prince Charles, didn't I? He's not Prince Charles. He's King Charles III. We saw him. We saw the boys, Harry and the other guy, William. You know, we saw Prince Andrew and everything. We were at the Trooping of the Colors a few years back, you know. Quite a few years back, because most of those people are gone now. Queen Mother. We saw the Queen Mother. I was saying that the other day. You couldn't hear me, I guess, because apparently my PA wasn't carrying over there. But I was saying, you know, I saw the Queen. I never met her. I said, I don't know anybody that actually met the Queen. And then it occurred to me when we were little, the Dalby's next door, old people, you know, Bob Dalby was an old man that liked to tell stories about himself. I hate people like that. But they brought this woman to stay at their house for a while, and she was an old woman. I mean, probably younger than I am now, but she was as old as the hills to me back when I was a little kid. And she had been a nanny for the Queen and when she was a princess, Princess Elizabeth and Princess Margaret when they were little girls back in England. So I actually had met somebody that actually met the Queen and knew the Queen when she was a little girl. Song about a woman who really let me down. Dina Manfredini is the oldest woman in the world. Lives seven blocks from here. She's a real elusive girl. When you hit 115, there's only one place you can go. Dina Manfredini's on the throne. Betty Cooper died today. She was 116. The paparazzi camped out at her door. They told her, stay away. Can't you understand? There's better things to wind up famous for. Friends are dead and gone. There's no one else but you. No one else has seen what you've lived through. Dina Manfredini is the oldest woman in the world. Lives seven blocks from here. She's a real elusive girl. When you hit 115, there's only one place left to go. On the throne. Dina Manfredini's on the throne. Thank you. Thank you. John, did you know Dina Manfredini? That's John, isn't it? You don't know Dina Manfredini. I'll tell you the story. You know, she was the oldest woman in the world for 8 days. She really let me down. I knew, and she lived eight blocks away from me in Johnston at the Bishop Drum home. And I'd known for months before that the second oldest person in the world lived in Johnston. You know, my mother was telling me that. You know, and as the song says, when you hit 115, there's only one place you can go. So it's just a matter of waiting it out, you know. And one day, I'm sitting in my office, you know, on Facebook, you know, doing what I always did in my office back when I had one. You know, maybe why I don't have an office anymore. I saw the news report that the woman had died, the other woman. So all of a sudden, I'm eight blocks away from the oldest person in the world. You know, so I go home that night, and I write a song about her, you know, because I could tell you this, 115 years old, you know, there's a lot of things that's happened in her life, but I can guarantee you that nobody has ever wrote a song about her before. You know, so I was going to do that, and then I wrote it, and then I played it at Friedrich's. I don't know if you were there that night, that Friday night, 4 days later, and I was going to take it to the Bishop Drum home, but then the following Monday, you know, like they say, when you hit 115, there's only one place left to go, and she was gone. She was gone 8 days later. But, you know, interesting person. You know, she's the oldest woman in the world for 8 days. She came from Italy as a young baby. As far as they know, she's the oldest Italian in the history of Italy, the oldest immigrant in the history of immigrants to the United States, the oldest Iowan in the history of Iowa. And I found out from reading her obituary, most of her life she spent in Valley Junction. I grew up in West Des Moines. She went to the same church I went to. I probably saw her in church every Sunday. You know, but when I moved to Iowa in 1964, you know, at 8 years old, she was already as old as I am now. When I was in high school, she was well into her 70s. I don't start looking at them till they're 100, you know. So I never did get to see her. But anyway, Dina Manfredini. I don't know why I asked you, John. I didn't know Dina Manfredini. So I'm just thinking, well, who's the oldest person I know, you know? But... Yeah. But who are the two oldest people in the courthouse when we were there? No, you and me. Yeah, and now it's all a bunch of young, smart people. All, you know, all those people, all the dead woods cleared out, and the IQ of the courthouse has just gone up about 30 points with me gone, and the old muscle. We were the muscle, you know, and now the brains are left, you know. And you remember that. You remember that. Muscle, that's what we were. John changed the whole course of history. I won't say why, actually, my best friend in the courthouse, really, all the years I was there, and he was a prosecutor. My best friend in the courthouse was a prosecutor. My nephew married a prosecutor. He married an AUSA last month. So anyway, off that topic, trying to forget about it. You know, she said, "Well, I'm not an AUSA anymore. I quit. I joined a law firm." It's in your DNA. Once you've done it, you've always done it. You know, John was actually the best one. No, John was our good friend. Actually, he tried to be reasonable. He caught hell for that. He caught holy hell for being reasonable. You know, and I guess I wasn't so reasonable though. Really, I tried to be the most unreasonable person in the room, basically, if I could do it. And back in the day, I couldn't, but I think today I could. So because everybody's smart now, the muscle's gone, and now it's just smart people. So, and you know what they say about smart people?
Intelligence is overrated.
That's right, muscle. So anyway, interestingly enough, that's not my best song about old women who die. This one is, actually. This is about a woman from my hometown of Worcester, Massachusetts, who died at the relatively young age of 99. You know, and I figured out from reading her obituary that she worked in the same company that my dad worked in 7 years at the same time. You know, and my dad doesn't even pretend to remember her. You know, in my family, at least you would pretend. Remember the woman who sat at this desk here 24/7 for 27 years. She died on Saturday. I saw it on the news today. She had a secret that she carried to the grave. She went down with good old Molly Brown, pushed up off the bottom. Somehow didn't drown. It was not her time. She lived to 99, right up until Saturday. She buried it inside. Remember the woman? I don't think I can. Didn't have children. Doubt she ever had a man. Each day quietly, she'd do her job across from me. One of those people that you don't tend to see. She went down with good old Molly Brown, pushed up off the bottom, somehow didn't drown. It was not her time. She lived to 99, right up until Saturday. She buried it inside the sight of her daddy. Back there on the deck, still smiling and waving with the water at his neck. They say time heals every wound. I guess 99 years was way too soon now. She's there with him in a warm, dry sitting room. She went down with good old Molly Brown, pushed up off the bottom, somehow didn't drown. It was not her time. She lived to 99, right up until Saturday. She buried it inside. She went down with good old Molly Brown, pushed up off the bottom, somehow didn't drown. It was not her time. She lived to 99, right up until Saturday. She buried it beside. Thank you. So the name of that song is Lillian Aspin. Lillian Aspin was the last American survivor of the Titanic, the last person alive who could remember being in the Titanic. There were some people who had been infants that survived it, but they're all gone now too. And every year, obviously, on the 14th and 15th of April, we mark the sinking of the Titanic, and April 14th and 15th, 1912. As you all know, April 14th and 15th are not good days in American history for the obvious reason, which is what? Tax Day, somebody always says, the assassination and death of President Abraham Lincoln in 1865, you know, at the same time. Taxes is good, too. Taxes is a good answer, too. But that's her story. A lot of those songs I've been playing, and I usually start off with that one about if you die in Iowa, you know. Get anymore, you know, my performances kind of slow down a little bit. Coffee shops won't bring in music anymore because of the muscling from the ASCAP and BMI and everything has been forced out of having music, and so, and playing original songs in bars, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. I don't do it so much. I'm an old man anyway, so, you know, I do farmers markets and stuff like that. So, but one of the places that I had played before the pandemic, at least, I'd started doing was the retirement communities. You know, because for one thing, I'm old enough to be in one of those places myself, you know. And they're good audiences. The shows are shorter. I like to do like 3-4 hour shows, you know. I like it because I could play more of my stuff, you know. You play an hour, 45 minutes. They're very, very appreciative audiences. But I worried about it because those songs, you know, those songs I just played and everything are kind of what I would play in a show like that. But when I first started doing them, I worried about, you know, they're all songs about old people that die. You know, how's that going to play? You know, and I'd asked the activities directors at the retirement communities, you know, what are they going to do? And I play a bunch of old songs about old people that die. They don't care. They go, they're used to it. It happens all the time. And I did, and it works out really well and everything. This is the one they don't like. And I played this song once at Wesley Acres, and one of my best friend's mother and father had just moved in there, and the mother came up to me after I got done playing, and she goes, you know that song you played, don't play that anymore. Old people don't want to hear this and everything. And of course, you know me, when somebody tells me not to do anything, you know, I just start doing it every show and everything. And you know, I felt bad because she passed away like a couple weeks after that, and I went to the wake and I said, you know, she's a mother, a good friend of mine, Paul, you know, sorry, I think I killed your mom. And he goes, no, she was on her way out anyway. But anyway, 15 years ago, my mother and father moved out of the house, you know, the house that we'd lived in since 1965. And April 10th, 1965, we moved into the house. You know, I grew up in there. And my mother couldn't do the stairs anymore, and she was starting to get a little dementia and everything. And so they moved out. They hadn't sold it yet, but they moved into an apartment. When they left, they took what they could take. They gave away what they could give away. They sold what they could sell, and they moved out. And the following Monday after they moved out, it occurred to me that the one thing that was still there was the piano. You know, the piano that my father had bought for my mother back in 1957, right after I was born, so that she'd have something to do rather than just raise me. You know, and it was the piano I learned to play on. I wrote probably my first 500 songs on that piano and everything, and it was just sitting in the basement. Whoever buys the house is just going to junk that piano. It's out of tune. You know, there's keys that stick and everything else. It's never going to be a good piano. But I can't let it go. So I hired two men in a truck to come out to the house, you know, to pick up the piano. And they did on a Friday afternoon. I took the afternoon off, and I went down, and we extracted it from our basement in West Des Moines, and took it out to the house in Johnston, and brought it down the basement there. And then they left, and I had the rest of the afternoon, me and this instrument that I hadn't touched for decades. You know, the instrument that I basically was raised on. And so I just started playing it. And it was a stream of consciousness, whatever came into my head. This song came into my head. This is something I wrote in 1991. And like that Queen song that I played earlier, I never memorized it or anything else, and I never performed it for anybody, but it was all there. So I played this song. Tonight we grill our brats and beer. It's how we've always done it here. A warm April Sunday at the house. Dad tells that joke, it's getting old.
I've heard it 3 weeks in a row. He'll tell it next Sunday at the house. At the house, the Sundays, they fly. The holidays come, then it's July. Next thing you know, they put up a realty sign. At the house. One month shy of 9 years old, took a drive down Ashworth Road, turned in the driveway of the house. Wore out 3 fine baseball gloves. I saw high school and first love. Sometimes I still see her at the house. At the house, the Sundays, they fly. The holidays come, then it's July. Next thing you know, they put up a realty sign at the house. Bye, Josh. I drifted out, then I returned. It was a bridge I couldn't burn. I left an anchor at the house. Tonight we grill our brats and beer. It's how we've always done it here. A warm April Sunday. Warm April Sunday at the house.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Good. Do you have any great-grandchildren, John? Do you have any? One? Last week? Really? I'm getting mine next week. Seriously, I'm getting mine next week on the 21st. Yeah, you beat me again. But you're also a little older than me, so, you know. So I think I was younger than you when I had got my first one, probably, that I know of, you know. But anyway. Well, anyway, why don't we cut to the chase? You know, I'll play the highlight of my show right now. Since you're all here and you all came out and everything, and I'm down to my last 11 minutes, I'm going to play the highlight of my show. And it's just a 12-bar blues song. It's really nothing special. Is that Judge Bremer? How you doing, Judge? Boy, we got a couple judges here. Judge Pratt was here. And is that Doug? Is that Doug? Doug flew all the way. He flew all the way to California to watch me play my show, and he did. He flew all the way to California just to watch me play that show, didn't you? At Redlands last month, and now he drove down from Ankeny. Now I say Ron Gilbert came down from Cedar Rapids, so I don't know. And then Nancy came from Lincoln, Nebraska. So it's good to see you, Judge. Yeah, thanks for coming to my show. All the judges are leaving. They must know something bad's coming now. I didn't have anything bad planned. I was going to go to the highlight of my show. 12-bar blues song. Got the mayor of Johnston. Got the president. Had the president of the Bar Association. I think he's still up there somewhere. And I'm going to be a great grandfather next week. So anyway, it's quite a potpourri. Frederick Potpourri and Haggerty Windows and Siding. We got the county recorder, who's technically up for re-election this year, but nobody's running against you. What the heck? That never stopped them. But anyway. I see the signal.
But I still don't see the train. I see the signal, but I still don't see the train. My good sense tells me to stop and wait. My heart keeps saying, you can't have faith. Where have you been? Sad and lucky since 10:15, waiting for you, when just last month I watched all my dreams come true. I see the signal, but I still don't see the train. I see the signal, but I still don't see the train. My good sense tells me to stop and wait. My heart keeps saying, you can't have fate. And I played this in California, didn't I? Did I play all these same songs, or did I do something new here? Did I play something new today, or did you hear all these songs in California? I'll say a word, because I can't fall for a lie I haven't heard. Even from you, I just close my eyes and tell myself it's true. I see the signal, but I still don't see the train. I see the signal, but I still don't see the train. Is that another federal judge? Is that right? Boy. I still keep smiling, but all my nights are blue. I see the signal, but I still don't see the train. I see the signal, but I still don't see the train. My good sense tells me to stop and wait. My heart keeps saying, I see the signal, but I still don't see the train. No, babe, I still don't see the train. My good sense tells me to stop and wait. My heart keeps saying. I see the signal. Highlight of my show. Thank you. If I'm playing that song, people come by on the street or something, they'll come in. This guy is good, you know, and they'll sit down. If it's a restaurant, they'll order food and everything. Whatever I play after that, they get up and leave, you know, because it's the highlight of my show, and everything is downhill after that. But I'm basically down to two more songs, really, so, you know, hopefully you won't get up and leave for the last two songs. Give this one a try. This is a brand new one, and hopefully I got it memorized. Getting that? Is that coming out? Okay. And I'm gonna finger pick this, so you know, you gotta turn it up so you can hear it, or turn it down because I'm not a good finger picker. At your own discretion. But at any rate. The story behind this song is that one of the restaurants that we frequent is one of the servers there, somebody who has had a lot of difficulty in their life in the last, well, for a long time, and is a server in the restaurant. Bye, Judge. Thank you for coming. It's good to see you. And she's also an artist. She does various types of art and everything. And she's on the social media a lot. And recently, she did a post saying, you know, I've been suffering so long and everything. It's time to, you know, it's time for me to pull myself together. And she says, it's time to turn the heartache into art. And I thought, what a nice song. It'd almost be a nice song to close on, but I've got my closing song, you know. So I'll play this one and then play my closing song. ¶¶
choose to wallow now. I get it, cause you're working through lost ground. And you're just not inspired to address it for a while. This time it comes back slow. This time it comes back slow. For some reason you're not ready to let it go. Then you work up one morning like you finally made it home. There's no point in wrestling the forces that pulled you apart. The brushes laid out on the writing desk. It's time to turn the heartache into art. Some use for what you've learned at the outset when you're thinking you won't get burned. And 10 minutes later, when it takes that ugly turn, you weren't prepared at all. Rip off your glasses and admit it's your own damn fault. And if there's a lesson, it's just never get involved. There's no point in wrestling the forces that pulled you apart. The brushes laid out on the writing desk. It's time to turn the heartache into war. Turning something so dark into an object of beauty becomes your raison d'etre. It's your prayer, it's your duty, you're not reading for the part. There's no point in wrestling the forces that pulled you apart. The brushes laid out on the writing desk. It's time to turn the heartache into art. Thank you. Thank you very much. So that's a brand new one. That'll be off in just a second. It's coming. It's coming. It's coming. It's coming. That's a real picture, by the way. That was, John did that from a real picture when we were on the, not, that's not out of the book. Buy the book, by the way. Anyway, it's off of Garbage Day. You know, my next CD that I'll start recording in about 3 weeks and everything. So thank you for coming out tonight. I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you to xBK for letting me do this. You know, it's a wonderful, wonderful facility, actually. I've seen some great concerts out here. Some of the people that play here on Monday nights, especially with Ducharme Jones and Scott Sutherland, you're thinking you're watching Austin City Limits and everything. You know, they bring in somebody like Andy Hoyt or Patricia Hartman or somebody, great songwriters, and they sit with those guys, and it's great. It's great. And I've watched live streams out of here, and it's just like watching, like I say, Austin City Limits. So. Thank you for letting me be on this stage, actually, and do my thing. I have to say thank you for that championship series back in whatever year that was, Bondurant. It was your dad drug us to those games. You know, was it the 3A or the 2A and everything, and Bondurant's playing for the champion. And they always let themselves get behind like 20 points, you know. It's almost like the Iowa Hawkeyes. But they're just toying. They're just toying with the other team. These two guys toying with the other team. And they got right down to the last, like, the 15.5 seconds, just boom, 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 boom. And it's like, you know, I don't even care, but my heart's about to stop, you know. You know, so that was a great, I'll never forget that. What year was that? 1997, 25 years ago. Boy, you should have like a reunion. You probably do have a reunion, don't you? Yeah. Did they bring you out on the court during the state championships and say, hey, these are the guys that gave everybody heart attacks back in 1997, you know. That's the year of the septuplets also, I remember that. And yeah, and then Princess Diana died, and then on the same night, what happened? Don't help him. What happened the same night that Princess Diana died? You know? Do you know?
No.
Oh, where were you? Where were you the night that Princess Diana died? You're at your dad's wedding.
No.
Yeah. Anyway. I'm going over time. Here's my last song. It's been it's off my album Badass Storm 2020 from 2020. And once again, I wrote it and I thought this is a good. And Renee's heard it 1,000 times. These guys have heard it 1,000 times. And until I write something better, this will be my closing song. I've been doing this for all of my life. It's the one thing I know. And it's brought me to a few hidden corners of the globe. Now I'm sailing into that stage in life. Started taking it slow. But I still dream the dream. Doubt I'll ever let it go. I will play where I can play, some dark corner or a stage. I've got something for whatever you can take. I'm not a complicated man. All I'm asking is to stand here if you let me have an hour with this mark in my hands. With this mark in my hand. On a little bench on Second and Grand sits a man with a horn. He's been playing there since almost the year I was born. And it used to be a joke with my friends, I would wind up like him. Now I see him and I realize how lucky he's been. I will play where I can play, some dark corner or a stage. I've got something for whatever you can pay. I'm not a complicated man. All I'm asking is to stand here if you let me have an hour with this mark in my hand. With this mark in my hand. It's not the best thing for my health. I'm not acquiring great wealth, but I go on because I owe it to myself. I'm not reaching for the stars. Things will stay the way they are. But I keep plugging. Oh, I may never get that far. I will play where I can play. Some dark corner for a stage. I've got something for whatever you can pay. I'm not a complicated man. All I'm asking is to stand here. If you let me have an hour with this mark in my. Mark in my hands. I will play where I can play. Some dark corner or a stage. I've got something for whatever you can pay. I'm not a complicated man. All I'm asking is to stand here if you let me have an hour with this mark in my hands. With this mark in my hands. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Thank you for coming out. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Say